What is Christianity all about? Why are we here? Why are we gathered here? Because we're free. What does it mean to be a Christian? You know, most people have their ideas about this, about these questions. What does it mean to be a Christian? But in the end, it's God's ideas that are most important. What does God say about Christianity? And we've started a series last week using the teaching material of two ways to live. And during this series, we are going to learn God's definition of Christianity as he spells it out. So if you've come to church for the first time today, you've made a good decision. Why don't we, all our regulars, welcome all of our newcomers here this morning. You are welcome. You're welcome in this place. So last Sunday was our first week, and we started at the beginning of creation. So I just want to give you a little review to remind ourselves and for those who weren't here. And you might think, what does creation have to do with Christianity? Well, you see, Jesus Christ doesn't arrive in a vacuum. He arrives as a culmination of God's plan. And in their outworking, God's plan being outworked in history. He arrives in the context of all that God has already revealed about himself and humanity. But here's the thing about creation. Most postmodern people do not understand or share the belief that God is the loving creator of everything. And if we are to know the gospel, and if we are to share the gospel, then these basic assumptions, like we have to include this because people's basic assumptions don't include God as loving creator. And in this series, we hope to fill in the wider story of the Bible so that the message of Jesus Christ makes sense. So we start at the beginning. It's always good to start at the beginning, isn't it? It's vital because our origins, they form our identity and they fuel our purpose. Knowing that you have been created by a loving God changes your whole outlook on life. Yes, you might want to get the phone. Is that God speaking? Is he calling? Maybe everybody else wants to check their phones right now. Good opportunity. Is it on silent? So knowing God as creator of all things makes him the owner. This is what we saw last week. If God is the creator of all things, it makes him the owner of all things and the ruler of all things. A creator, an owner, a ruler has a right to command obedience. Now, most people here, you own something. I'll give you an example of owning your car. You're the owner of the car. You're not the creator of it, but you're the owner of it. And being an owner of your car gives you the entitlement to decide where it goes, who gets in it, who cleans it, who pays for the petrol. Like, you think about it, it's your space, it's your property, and because it's yours, you rule it. Would you say yes? You've probably never thought about it like that, but if somebody tried to take it from you, you know, you're like, that's mine. Don't do that. You can't do that to my car. Whereas God, he is both creator and owner. That's bigger. He created everything and he's the owner of everything, which gives him authority over everything. You see, understanding creation puts God in his rightful place and it puts humanity in our rightful place. And last week's key scripture is Revelation 4:11. Can we read it together? You ready? Our Lord and God, you are worthy to receive glory and honor and power because you have created all things, and because of your will, they exist and were created. So we saw that God is the loving ruler of the world, that God made the world, and that God made us rulers of this world under him. That is the story of Genesis chapter 1 and 2 in the beginning of the Bible. And if you want a much broader understanding of creation and you miss the message, you can listen to it on our YouTube channel, Voyage Coffs Coast. I've also got the handouts. I've got about 3 copies from last week's handouts. If you want one, come and see me, because it actually gives alternatives to non-biblical worldviews about creation, and it shows you the folly of those understandings. But is this the way the world is now, that God is a good creator and he created everything good and everything is good? Is that the way that it is now? What has gone wrong? We're going to watch a short clip. Actually, when I was making that, it's the first video I've made. So yeah, now I get it with some appreciation. I was so confronted by the images, as like I'm looking at the images going, yeah, what has gone wrong with the world? So we're going to turn to that. What has gone wrong with our world, with us, and our relationship with God? So here we turn to our second point of the message of this series. And what we'd like to do now is actually get a Bible in your hand if you didn't bring one, and I'm going to hand out the message outline. So those that are involved in doing that, those that want a Bible, lift your hand up, keep it up until a Bible gets in your hand. Otherwise, you'll get missed. And if the guys could hand out their message outlines now, James and Frank, please. And with these message outlines, you've got a pen. I encourage you, I'm going to be quoting extra scriptures for you to take home. Don't leave the message outlines here, take them home. And also discuss them in your V group this week, because you'll be spending some time discussing this. So take notes for V group as well. That's it. So just if you just hand a pile out and then pass them along. James, if you give them the pile, pass them along. That's it. Excellent. Our key scripture for those that are looking up is page 170 of the Thirst Quencher Bible. And for those that have got their own Bibles, it's Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 12. Page 170, Romans chapter 3. Have we got that slide there with the scripture? That's the wrong scripture, Romans 3. Maybe that's my fault. It's Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 12, page 170. Okay, that's my fault. So have we got it? Are we getting there? Romans chapter 3, page 170, verses 10 to 12. Yeah, don't look at that on the screen. Maybe take that one off. Once more, Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 12, page 170. Have we got it, everyone? Just yell out, got it. Even if you haven't got it, say it by faith. I got it. So we'll move on. Are we ready? We're going to read it. I'm going to read it. You follow along. There is no one righteous. That word righteous means right with God. There is no one right with God. Not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. all have turned away. The sermon or the message today is about humanity in rebellion. It's important for us to understand this. For people to accept the gospel, it's critical to understand humanity's sin against God and to understand it clearly, because it's actually one that a lot of non-Christians most often misunderstand, and I would add to that that a lot of Christians don't fully grasp. When we are communicating the two ways to live, and we get to the end of sharing the gospel with somebody and we ask them this question, hey, where do you think you are now? So I'm projecting forward. Which way are you living now? Are you living God's way, his new way, or are you living your way? It's very common for people to say, oh, I'm halfway in between. I'm not sure. And this is because they haven't understood this point about humanity being in rebellion against God. This is a unique teaching. No other religion or teaching has this, and it's the one that most people don't understand. So we're going to look at the key concepts. So on your outline, the nature of sin. What actually is sin? It's deeper than what you might think. Here's where the issue is with people. People think of sin. When you say sin, they think of it as rule breaking, as individual acts of wrongdoing, such as stealing or lying or murdering someone. And when you look up sin in the dictionary, I googled dictionary.com, it's defined as transgression of divine law. And people feel quite good about themselves because although they would admit that they do transgress, that they do break a law or they break the rules of a moral code from time to time, they also manage to keep some of the rules as well. They don't steal all the time. They don't lie all the time. If they do, they classify those. Well, no, I only tell little white lies. Somehow a white lie is better than a black lie. Or they don't always commit adultery and so on. And so they regard themselves as doing okay with a reasonable chance of being accepted by God. But this is not how the Bible understands sin at all. The individual acts are the symptoms of the problem. But it's far more profound, it's far deeper, and it's actually one that all of us share. We all reject the rule of God. As our main scripture says, Romans 3, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. You see, we try to run life our own way without him. And this is sin. It's rejection of God. It's rebellion against him, the creator. It's stepping out from under his rule and declaring independence. That song, I did it my way. It's saying we wish to run things our way and not your way. Sin is the disease. The individual acts such as stealing and lying and cheating and all of those things that we think of, murder, they're all symptoms of the disease, but the disease is the rebellion against God, and it's deep in every human heart. You know it. Come on. We all tend to run towards and lean towards doing things my way. We see in 1 John 3:5 where sin is also defined. Sin, says John, is lawlessness. Lawlessness. Not trying to keep the law, but lawlessness. Not law breaking so much as law making. It's setting ourselves above and outside the law. Romans 1 paints a similar picture. It's not just individual acts of wrongdoing, here it is, but a decision to deny or oppress the truth of God and embrace a lie instead. All this yields all sorts of consequences in terms of our behaviour. This is why the key scripture in Romans 3 this morning illustrates the concept so well, because it's about turning away from God, not seeking God. I'm going to read it again. There is no one righteous. There's no one, not even one. No one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. Everyone is turning away and going their own way. That is why there's no one righteous. That's the connection of what sin is. Doing our own thing whenever we like, to whoever we want, whatever. Our sin, or our independence from God, self-ruling, self-governing, self-reigning, this has caused the rift in our relationship with God. We have initiated it and we sustain it. That's the nature of sin. Has everyone got a clear understanding of sin? Maybe before you came in, you thought sin was, oh, well, that's lying and I don't lie, so I don't sin. Or, no, that's adultery. Well, I've never committed adultery, so I'm okay. No, sin is the disease of independence, turning away from God, away from his rule. And this is universal. We all reject the rule of God by trying to run life our own way. Again, this is the stress of Romans chapter 3. But the whole chapter, actually, our verse this morning is just a snippet. If you want to write this down, if you want to really read into this, read all of Romans chapter 3, where Paul's saying, whether you're Jew or Gentile, no matter whether you're Australian or African, whether you come from Asia or Alaska, all of us are alike under sin. You see the same in, you can write this down, Romans chapter 5. Verses 12 to 18, and in 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 to 10, I've got the scriptures on the screen that you can write down, where the scripture says, anyone who claims to be without sin is not only self-deceived, but calls God a liar as well. This is a unique and realistic view of the world. The Bible says that all people are liars, and that is the truth that everyone knows in their hearts. I was thinking about that myself. How quickly do I lean to, if you're backed into a corner, you start telling half-truths? Like, you don't want to be exposed, so you gentle, soften the blow, and it's not really how it was. Deep down, we all have sin. It's incredibly true. All people can and do tell lies, yeah? But it's only Christianity that has this negative but accurate view of humanity. What are the consequences of our rebellion, of our sin? So on your outline, consequences. This is our third concept. And there are several. One is that we find ourselves under God's wrath. If you're American, you would say wrath. But we say wrath, but it's spelled wrath. That's God's anger, God's judgment. And that's going to be our next message next Sunday. So I do encourage you, come. And then come after that, because there's good news coming, yeah? There's good news on the way. But unless we understand this, how can we accept the good news that has come? The more immediate consequence of our rebellion is that we all fail to rule. We fail to rule ourselves, our society, and our world. We declare autonomy or independence from the rightful ruler, and in so doing, we make an absolute mess of it. Just seeing those images on that clip, wow, what a mess. We fail in a number of areas. Firstly, we fail to control ourselves. We all want to look that it's somebody else's fault, it's somebody else's failure, because in rebelling against God, fleeing from his government, from his rule, we actually find ourselves under the rule of another. And this is under the rule of the evil one. could everyone turn in their Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2, 1 to 3. It puts it very well. It's page 228. Maybe write this down on your message outline, Ephesians chapter 2, 1 to 3. When I was studying this week, I hadn't seen this so clearly. All right, so I'm going to read it. This is the context. Paul's writing to a church, and he's basically saying, before you discovered Jesus, before you believed in Christ, this is who you were, and this is who the world is without Christ. Once you were dead, now he doesn't mean physically dead, he means spiritually dead. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. You used to live in sin. Again, think about it. You used to live doing whatever you wanted, whenever you wanted. You gave God no second thought, or you defied God and you just lived independently. That's who you were. You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. And all of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclination of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger just like everyone else. Because of being under sin, our nature is changed. We let ourselves down and we do it constantly. We can't control ourselves and we can't understand why. Having bought the lie that God is not God and we've set up our own kingdom, it seems that everything we try to do just ends up wrong. And even when we recognize that something isn't right, we still find it impossible to do. And write this down, Romans chapter 7. This is where Paul's saying, I know the right thing to do, and every time I try to do the right thing, I just fail. Help! Like, why do I keep failing? Why is this going on? And what I found fascinating through the week in reading the Word and these notes was that when we choose to live our own way, when we declare autonomy, I mean, the world today, the culture today celebrates autonomy. It celebrates going your own way, doing whatever you like. Yet when we do that, we've just read in Ephesians 2, we're not actually free at all. We're actually handing over rulership from a loving God who created and made us, and we're giving it to the power of the devil. You see, we're deceived. We think, oh no, if I turn away from God, or I don't even know who God is, I'm not even going to investigate that, I'm just going to do life my own way. You're not even doing life your own way. You're under the influence and control of someone who wants to kill, steal, and destroy you. You actually become a slave to sin. And Helen said brilliantly at the beginning when I said, what's Christianity all about? She said, freedom! Coming under God's rule and reign and being free from the power of sin and the enemy, the evil one. When we're under his power, when we're under sin, when we're disobedient to God, it's seen in our relationships, marriages. Wow, outside of the Garden of Eden, divorce becomes a reality. Deuteronomy chapter 24, if you're taking notes, and Matthew chapter 19 point this out. There is hostility between husband and wife. We also become alienated from each other in society. We lie, we cheat, we kill one person to another. I mean, on the news last night, they had women assaulting one another over toilet paper. And there's charges and it's out of control. We're selfish. We're in hostility. We don't care about the other person. I don't care if you've got no toilet paper. I'm taking 10 packs. The whole thing's just gone crazy, hasn't it? Can you see, can you sense the fear? It's the power of the enemy. Oh, he's having a field day. People are frightened, worried, concerned that we, our nation, is running out of toilet paper. It's bizarre. What's the next thing to run out of?
I said the next aisle is tissues.
And there's plenty of tissues. Okay, everyone go to aisle 8. Tissues in aisle 8.
No, they're out too.
Oh, they're gone too. Serviettes. And newspapers. All right. I'm sure we used to survive without toilet paper hundreds of years ago. Anyway, we're getting sidetracked. It's crazy. We are in hostility with one another. What is going on? Why is there so much anger and selfishness? And this all takes place within a few verses in the beginning of the Bible of being ejected from the garden where humanity sees its first murder. But we also become alienated from the ground itself, from creation itself, where now it produces thorns and thistles. It's hard to say that word. Everyone say thorns and thistles. Thorns and thistles to trouble us and become alienated from the world as a whole. And Romans chapter 8 actually says creation, it's under the bondage of sin and decay, and creation itself is groaning. It's groaning for freedom, waiting to be liberated from its decay. All this is incredibly and obviously true just by looking around about us. The world is falling apart. Society is fragile and racked by evil and corruption. And our own lives are no better. The war starts within. We're all responsible. Well, this is the Bible's view of sin and its nature. And there are many alternatives that are put forward, and we're going to look at a couple. The first one is all are good. The first and most obvious one is that really, come on, really, Beck, we're all good. Deep down, we're okay. This is the one that's most commonly believed, and it's a humanistic view. That humanity really is good at heart. Yet, it flies in the face of history. It flies in the face of experience. And you've only got to turn on the 6 o'clock news. But it's what a lot of Westerners believe. The most common form of this is that something outside of us, such as society or perhaps our childhood, is really responsible for the wrong things we do. It's not me, it's the system. Society is to blame. It was my upbringing. Of course, society is made up of people, and if people are basically all good, it's a fair question to ask, where did the evil of society then come from, if we're all good? Why is society such a corrupting influence when it's made up of entirely good people? And our parents, if they were the ones who messed us up, why did they do that if they're really good people themselves deep down? Jesus pointed out the folly of this position, although he met it in a different form, and we're going to read it in Mark 7, 14 to 15. Jesus called to the crowd to come and hear. He said, all of you listen and try to understand. It's not what goes into your body that defiles you. You are defiled by what comes from your heart. Verse 20. Then he added, it is what comes from inside that defiles you. For from within, out of a person's heart, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, wickedness, deceit, lustful desires, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. All these vile things come from within. They are what defile you. The humanist alternative, in all of its forms, denies the reality of human sinfulness and tries to assert that we are really only made evil by forces outside of us. It's not my fault. We blame others for our own sinful acts. This view is really hard to sustain. The second alternative is equally hard to sustain, and that is sincerity. It's sincerity that counts. Provided people are sincere, they'll be okay. This view holds that there are no objective standards of right and wrong, or right doing or wrongdoing, but that each person should be judged by having done the right thing if they sincerely believed that what they were doing was right. But do we really want to say that about Adolf Hitler? Because he sincerely believed in his cause. Do we want to say that about the doctors of the 18th century? That they were right because they sincerely believed that bleeding their patients would cure them? Sincerity is a good indication of something. It's a good indication of sincerity. But it can't be a measure of right and wrong. And among those who accept there may be such a thing as sin, so those that maybe aren't living under the ruling or kingship or government of God, they might go, yeah, well, I actually can see that there's sin. There are some numerous positions for these, and one of them is the 50% solution. Those who don't understand that sin is rebellion against our Maker, they tend to think of it almost entirely as of breaking rules. And this in turn leads to the view that if we manage to keep 50% of the rules, then we might pass and God might let us into heaven. Right? So some admit to their own sin, but they admit that they're not entirely bad. If you just, you know, if you just do enough. And the other one is the spark of goodness. There's a spark of goodness in us all that only has to just be fanned into flame. And so by various methods and means, perhaps through church activities, if you just go to church enough, or other things, that goodness can be nurtured and lead us to become righteous people. Being acceptable by God. It's about what you do. It's doing to be made right with God. But this view has emerged in Christian history, and at times it's labelled as heresy because it's so false. But yet so many so-called Christians still think this way, that if I just do enough, I'll be okay with God. But the Bible is very, very clear. It's not that our souls are sick and are in need of some therapy or medicine. Our souls are dead. They're not sick, they're dead. They are dead in disobedience. We read this in Ephesians chapter 2. They are dead in transgression, like spiritually dead in sin. And they are in need of new life. Breathe into them from the outside. Isn't that true? We're not sick. The world isn't sick. The world is dead, dead in their sin. And this world needs new life breathed into them. If sin is fundamentally rebellion against our Creator, then this is what must be fixed. Stop dealing with the symptoms of sin and get to the disease. Not just the incremental improvement of moral acts. The relationship must be restored. And if it isn't, we're all stuck in sin. You can try positive thoughts. You can try certain prayers. You can try helping little old ladies cross the road every day of the week. That's just therapy. That's just medicine. It's not going to help dead souls. When something's dead, we've got Adrian here who's a paramedic in his field. Adrian, if you turned on site and someone was dead, did you start pumping stuff into them? And no, like they're dead. Once you pronounce, okay, time it, dead, it doesn't matter what medicine you try and put in that body, it's dead. And yet the world is trying to fix our solutions. Everybody's looking to the government to fix our solutions. Everyone's blaming the government for our problems and they want them to fix it. But the core root is, we're at fault. It's us. I was saying, I'm getting off my notes now, but I'm getting on a bit of a horsey here. I was saying to Mike yesterday, we saw an interview on the Today Show where, I don't know if you saw it, but a Maori guy tackled a young guy who was breaking into a chemist, and he tackled him, and he realised, oh, he's 15, I've got a son 15, and he just sat on, this big Maori guy just sits on this kid waiting for the police to come. And the interview, you know, was about what this guy did, and it was quite funny, and blah, blah, blah. And at the end of it, Mike said, you know what, the problem is, though, that kid is not going to bear any consequence for his decision, and he'll be out, he won't go to jail, he'll be out. And, you know, and then it started this conversation. I said, that's right, Mike. And I said, and they know it. Those kids, what about those kids that are hijacking those cars on the Gold Coast and they're just stealing cars because they know the cops can't do anything. And I said, that's right, because we've actually said we don't want to institutionalise our youth. Because when we do that, it actually creates more of a problem. Now, I'm not saying those children don't need consequences, but the problem is much bigger and much deeper. So we institutionalize them. Who do they end up with in jail? A lot of bad kind of guys. Then they get dependent on the system. Then the government has to create a system that can contain everyone who does petty theft. I mean, we need to just start keep building more and more prisons because, oh my goodness, this problem ain't going away. Then we need more money because we need people to run the jails. But then we have people that depend on this life of institutionalism and they get out and they don't know how to survive, so they commit another crime so they can go back in. I said to Mike, think about how many millions of dollars it costs taxpayers to keep one petty theft as a 15-year-old first breaking in because we throw him in jail. And then we look to the government and we say, well, what are you going to do about it? And I said to Mike, well, what did the parents do about it? Hold on. Back. But those parents, well, they're just dysfunctional and they were raised up by dysfunctional. I mean, Gavin's probably just looking at me because he's in this field going, maybe you want to take the mic, Gavin. But, oh my goodness, it's out of control. Why is it out of control? Everybody look within, please. Everybody, right now. I'm at fault. I'm sorry, Charlie, you're at fault. Ashley, we're all at fault. Because the fundamental thing is we have turned away from God. This nation has turned away from God and we now look to government to see it solve our problems because we will not come back under and humble ourselves and say, God, I'm at fault. You're the creator. We've turned away from you. And that's why we've got the mess. There we go. What do you think? Oh, I like that hobby horse. That was fun. Thanks for listening. Oh, it's so frustrating. It's so frustrating. And I've lost where I'm up to. So conclusion, do you want me to end? In conclusion. The essence of the biblical doctrine of sin is that our relationship with God has been fractured and we have done the fracturing. We've initiated it. We sustain it. We rebel against him and reject his rule over us and our world as the creator. This expresses itself many ways with our thoughts, our attitudes, our actions being opposite to God's way. It's a rebellion against the rightful claims of our creator. And so our point today, the message today, humanity in rebellion. But it requires last week's point, God as loving ruler and creator. Now, if you all want to turn your message outlines over, we've got some drawing to do today. Remember we did some drawing last week? So let's draw in box one, point one. Everybody draw a crown. Can I have that slide there? Great, thanks, honey. Everyone draw a crown at the top of the box. That represents that God is the loving ruler of the world. Draw a crown. He made the world. Draw a world. Charlie? Charlie. We should put them on the wall and just inspect each other's artwork. Start again, Charlie. So have we got it? Draw crown. God is the loving ruler of the world. He made the world, draw world. And then he made us rulers of the world under him, draw person. And if you do that and you look up, that's what your drawing should look like. Now let's go to box two. We all reject the ruler, God. Draw crown and then cross it out. By trying to run life our own way without him, draw rebel with our own crown. And we fail to rule ourselves or society or the world, draw world under God, under God's crown. Sin is the rebellion against God, who is your maker. Not against God in general, but against the Creator who has made you for his own purposes. Can you see how the story of creation is key to where the gospel message goes? Can you see it in your own life? God has made us for his own purposes, but we've taken that right off him. If you don't believe that God is the creator, then there really is no sin. The world doesn't understand this because it doesn't understand God as creator. And so it either denies the idea of sin altogether or it just turns it into rule breaking. That's why creation is a big part of the gospel story. The other thing our world now finds difficult to accept is that God will do anything about our rebellion against him. It's an important aspect of the gospel. And that is that God can, has, and will do something about human rebellion against him. And next Sunday, that's what we're looking at. What can, has, and will God do about this rebellion as we continue two ways to live? As we're getting ready to come around communion, we're just going to watch a video on sin.
Most people assume the Bible has a lot to say about how messed up humans are, and that's true. It's also true that the Bible's vocabulary about this topic sounds odd to modern people, using words like sin, iniquity, or transgression. And so the Bible's perspective on the human condition is often ignored or treated as ancient and backwards. This is really unfortunate. Because through these words, the biblical authors are offering us a deeply profound diagnosis of human nature. Iniquity describes behavior that's crooked, while transgression refers to breaking trust. And sin? This is actually the most common of these bad words in the Bible, so let's focus on it for a few minutes. Sin translates the Hebrew word chata and the Greek word hamartia. The most basic meaning of sin isn't religious at all. Chata simply means to fail or miss the goal. Like when the Israelite tribe of Benjamin trained a small army of slingshot experts, they could sling a stone at a hare and not chata, that is, fail or miss. Or there's a biblical proverb that warns against making hasty decisions because you're likely to chata your way, miss your destination. So in the Bible, sin is a failure to fulfill a goal. But what's the goal? Well, on page one of the Bible, we learn that every human is an image of God, a sacred being who represents the Creator and is worthy of respect. And so in this way of seeing the world, sin is a failure to love God and others by not treating them with the honor they deserve. You can see this idea in the famous code of conduct given to the Israelites, the Ten Commandments. Half of them identify ways you can fail at loving God, and the other half name ways you can fail at loving people. And the fact that both kinds of failure are combined shows that failing to honor God is deeply connected to failing to honor people. This is why in the Bible, sin against people is sin against God. Like when Joseph refuses to sleep with the wife of Potiphar, he says, "How could I sin against God?" In Joseph's mind, failing to honor a human made in God's image is a failure to love God. And so, sin is a failure to be truly human. But there's more. A fascinating thing about sin in the Bible is that most of the time that people are failing, they either don't know it, or even worse, they think they're succeeding. Like when Pharaoh wants to build Egypt's economy and protect national security, in his mind, this justifies enslaving the Israelites. He thinks it's good, and he's totally unaware that it's an epic fail. Or when King Saul is chasing David around the wilderness trying to kill him, he thought he was bringing a criminal to justice until he realizes he's the corrupt one. And he says, I have sinned. I am the failure. So sin is about more than just doing bad things. It describes how we easily deceive ourselves and spin illusions to redefine our bad decisions as good ones. So why are humans such bad judges between moral failure and success? Well, the first appearance of the word sin in the Bible offers an insight. There are these two brothers, Cain and Abel. Their parents had just given in to this beastly temptation to redefine good and evil by their own wisdom, and now Cain is faced with a similar choice. He's jealous and angry that God has favored his brother, and so God warns him, if you don't choose what is good, Chata is crouching at the door, it wants you. But you can rule over it. So in these stories, sin, or moral failure, is depicted as this wild, hungry animal that wants to consume humans. And we know how that story ends. The Bible is trying to tell us that failed human behavior, our tendency towards self-deception, it runs deep. It's rooted in our desires and selfish urges that compel us to act for our own benefit at the expense of others. And it leads to this chain reaction of relational breakdown. This is why in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul describes hamartia as a power or a force that rules humans. In his words, we are slaves to sin. He even says sin lives in us, so that the things I don't want to do, that's what I do. So with the word sin, the biblical authors are offering a robust description of the human condition. It's a failure to be humans who fully love God and others. It's our inability to judge whether we're succeeding or failing, and it's that deep, selfish impulse that drives much of our behavior. This is not a pretty picture of ourselves, but if we're honest, it's realistic. This is why in the Bible, the story of Jesus is such good news. He's depicted as the Creator become a truly human one who did not fail to love God and others. That is, he did not sin. And yet, he took responsibility for humanity's history of failure. He lived for others, and he died for their sins. And he was raised from the dead to offer them the gift of his life that covers for their failures. Or in the words of the apostles, he committed no sin, yet he carried our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to our sins and live to do what is right. And that's the story behind the biblical word for sin.
We're going to come around communion. And as we do, I want us to reflect on today's message. I don't want to brush over it quickly. The Bible says in 1 John 1, 5 to 10. I'm going to read this to you. This is the message we've heard from Jesus and now declare to you. God is light and there is no darkness in him at all. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God but go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. But if we are living in the light as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all our sin. If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. If we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar and showing that his word has no place in our hearts. The emblems, when they do come around, not yet, but when they come, the biscuit represents Christ's body, his suffering body, and the cup represents his shed blood that has the power to cleanse us today by believing in his sacrifice to cleanse us from all sin. This is a wonderful time to receive forgiveness. It's a wonderful time to make confession. It's more than just eating and drinking. It's confessing. It's trusting. It's remembering. It's thinking. We're assured that if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all wickedness. The freedom that's on the other side of confession is powerful. So if you're taking communion today, you are saying, I am believing in what God has done for me and taking away my sin. And so this is a time of confession, confessing your sins, confessing, admitting, you know what? Without God, I am a rebel. I'm doing life my own way. I tend to lean that way. But we can ask God to forgive us. And we can thank Jesus for his sacrifice to free us from sin, to free us from the evil one. He defeated, when he rose again, he defeated sin, death, the power of the enemy, so that when we believe in him and confess our sin to him, we can live in the same freedom. Our guilty consciences are washed clean and we are made righteous. There are now many righteous people that live before God, not because of what they do, but because who they trust, who they believe in. And this next song is called Come to the Altar. Now, the word altar is not so much. Once upon a time, it was like a big stage kind of thing. But now in the New Testament, the altar, it's not so much a place, but it's an act of coming before God in your heart, in his presence, with a contrite, repentant heart. And during this song, we're not going to sing it, it's just going to be played so that everyone can participate. I want to encourage you, quietly confess your sins to God. If you want to walk across the room and pray with someone else, confess your sins with another person. This too is biblical. In James 5:16, it says, confess your sins one to another so that you might be healed. So I want to encourage you, have freedom to get up and move around the building this morning or turn to somebody and say, hey, would you like to pray together? And maybe you'd like to confess your sin. Maybe it's a general confession. Or maybe you're moved to talk and pray about a specific thing. Just make sure it's genuine. So as the team comes now and hands out communion, let us consider, reflect, and confess before the Lord and thank him for Jesus.
Yeah. Oh, Father, this morning, I thank you, Lord God, that once I was blind, but now I see. Once I was lost, and you came and found me. Lord, I thank you, Father, for your great salvation. Lord, that even though sin abounded in my heart, your grace was more abundant. When I called upon you, Father, I didn't understand fully what I was doing, but Father, I've been enjoying the fruit ever since. Lord God, there's been such revelation, Father, Lord, in my life and in my heart. Lord, I thank you, Father God, Lord, that every day, Father God, we can walk in this fellowship. Lord God, as we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Oh, Lord, this morning as we look upon, Lord, the bread and the wine, Father, this morning, Lord, a complete sacrifice, body, soul, and spirit, healing, restoration, new life. Father God, you breathe your spirit into our dead bodies and you bring us alive. We thank you, Father God, that we can remember this morning, Father God, so many, Lord God, of your parables and your words, Father, that bring life and joy and victory, Father, to our hearts. Lord, that many more might realise, Father, Lord, the bondage of sin, Lord, and trust in you and rest in you and forgive their and give their lives to you, Father God, that you might do a great and mighty work within them. Thank you, Father, this morning. Lord, we thank you, Father God, for the efficacy of your blood and your bread. Father, your body and your blood that cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Oh, this morning, brethren, Lord, may this be a real experience, Lord, in your lives, Father, as we refresh, Father, Lord, our salvation, as we refresh, Father God, our lives by trusting more and more in him who loved us and gave himself for us. In his name, amen.
As the team comes, is there anyone else who would like to pray? Just lift your hand and I'll come over. Who would like to give a prayer of thanksgiving this morning?
Yeah, good morning. I think this is all pretty much appropriate and worthy of saying, and I just say thank you, Lord, for these teachings. Thank you for the safe house where you present these teachings. Thank you for opening our eyes and filling our hearts. We need this filling, as there's a lot of emptiness out there, and there's a lot of challenges. And these things, and we're not going to answer that phone either, Lord. These things are very, very important to us all, as they can help rebuild lives. They can help us understand your way better and help us climb back to a closer relationship with you. And we all yearn that relationship and we all want that, but we stumble in the process, Lord. So these teachings, your word, are just going to help us. And we thank you. Thank you, Lord, from the bottom of our hearts for these opportunities. Amen.
Anyone else? Let's all stand up. Just one more person to pray. Just around the table of the Lord.
Father, I just praise you for your beautiful Son. We thank you for the way he walked in this earth and just showed us how to live, for his purity and his love and the ideal of how to be as a human. Lord, and I just praise you that you clothe us with your righteousness. Lord, that each one of us, as we come to you, we confess that we can't measure up. And we look to you in your perfection, your beauty, your wholeness. Lord, and we know that you offer that to us. And we take that this morning. And we want to walk from here, Lord, just purely dressed in your righteousness, Lord. I pray that our hearts would match our clothing, that we would be righteous in our hearts. Create in us, Lord, a clean heart so that we can be acceptable to you, Father. Thank you that you did all that you did on the cross. Thank you that your blood washed us whiter than snow, and we can stand before you fully accepted, fully loved. Praise you, Jesus.